The centerpiece of the MagForce Nano Cancer Therapy is the nanoparticle, consisting of iron oxide. The particle is covered by a patented coating which ensures a good stability and division of the iron oxide particles in the tumor tissue. It additionally supports the process by which the particles are absorbed into the cancer cells. The small size of the particle is decisive for the therapy. The diameter measures some 20 nanometers and is thus 500 times smaller than a red blood cell. 1 milliliter of the particle solution contains nearly 17 trillion single nanoparticles. This high density makes efficient treatment possible. At the beginning of the therapy, the nanoparticles are injected directly into the tumor. The tumor in this particular case is a glioblastoma, a malignant brain tumor characterized by aggressively growing cells. On the microscopic level, the healthy cells can be seen on the left and the tumor cells on the right. After being injected, the nanoparticles spread out in the spaces between the tumor cells. The patient now enters the therapy device in which an alternating magnetic field is produced, which is of no danger to humans. This field affects a 100,000 times alternation of the magnetic poles within the particles per second, creating warmth which is precisely regulated from the warmth forces the particles into the spaces between the tumor cells, which makes it easier for them to cell. This application is repeated and the thermally. The particles begin to oscillate, causing the cancer cells to die either from active self-destruction or from swelling until they literally burst. Tumor growth is stopped and the destroyed cells, as well as the nanoparticles, are discharged by the body in a natural process. As a rule, the 1 hour minimal invasive treatment is repeated 6 times. However, the particles are only injected once, thus making the therapy especially gentle on the patient.
The idea is that the nanotechnology enables diagnosis to get a lot better. Diagnosis.
The problem is to get a drug molecule, and the drug molecule is probably going to be very toxic, if it, you know, particularly if it's an anti-cancer drug. These are very nasty chemicals. You've got to get that, release the molecule so it can do its job. You'd like the vehicle to break up, releasing its payload when it gets to the place where it's needed. So, for example, an anti-cancer drug, when it gets to the tumour, you'd like it to break up there. And that could happen through a trigger like heat. So if the tumours are sometimes slightly hotter than their surroundings, so if you arranged it so that the heat made the vehicle break up, that would work. Another thing that people are trying is using light. So if you illuminated the tumour from outside with a laser, then that light could trigger the vehicle to break up. So there are quite a lot of different ways that you can.
Which nanotechnology can greatly improve cancer diagnosis and cancer treatment. Diagnosing and treating cancer can be a challenge because tumors can hide anywhere in the body, and anti-cancer treatments like chemotherapy and radiation affect normal tissues, not just cancer cells, causing side effects. Nanotechnology is a revolutionary new approach to cancer that's showing great promise. What is nanotechnology and how does it work? Nanoparticles are incredibly tiny, so small that 100,000 of them would fit on a single human hair. Nanoparticles can be administered to patients intravenously. They easily float through the bloodstream, seeking out cancer cells wherever they may be hiding. Some nanotechnology is designed to seek out cancer cells and attach to them, using specialized receptors which bind to the tumor selectively. Once bound to the tumor, the nanoparticles send out signals that tell doctors where it's located. This can help accurately visualize tumors that would not show up on conventional medical scans. Other nanotechnology is designed not only to find the cancer cells, but to kill them selectively using specific receptors that attach only to the tumor without injuring nearby normal tissues. With time, the nanoparticles are completely eliminated from the body. These are just two applications of nanotechnology
to build new tools that are actually smaller than cells. giving them the opportunity to attack cancer at the cellular and genetic level. This technology not only enables health practitioners to detect cancer earlier, but also holds the promise of stopping cancer before it even develops. Evolutionary approach. Besides, doctors will be able to design a unique treatment for an individual's own medical and genetic profile. Based on computer chip technology, diagnostic devices such as nanoarrays are thousands of times more sensitive and accurate than current techniques. Because of their size, multiple lab tests can be done more rapidly and at a much lower cost using one nano device instead of many. Nanoshells can be linked to antibodies that recognize tumor cells. Once they are taken up by the cancer cells, near-infrared light is applied, killing only the tumor and leaving neighboring, healthy cells intact. Scientists are engineering nanoparticles, such as dendrimers, to seek out and destroy cancer cells. This amazing technology can be customized for targeted drug delivery, improved imaging, and near real-time confirmation of cancer cell death. Moving research from bench to bedside is an important goal of the National Cancer Institute's Alliance in Cancer. It is underway to share research information across scientific around the world. As biomedical applications of nanotechnology evolve, scientists are ensuring that nano devices are safe for both the body and the environment. The National Cancer Institute is optimistic that through coordinated and responsible development, technology will dramatically change cancer patient care. The science is at our fingertips. In 80,000 times smaller than the breadth of a ridge on a fingertip, unlocking a new frontier into cancer research. Nanotechnology, the science of building small, is changing the way we look at cancer. More importantly, the way we look at diagnosis and treatment. Nanotechnology allows researchers to build new tools that are actually smaller than cells, giving them the opportunity to attack cancer at the cellular and genetic level. This technology not only enables health practitioners to detect cancer earlier, but also holds the promise of stopping cancer before it even develops. This revolutionary approach, doctors will be able to design a unique treatment for an individual's own medical and genetic profile. Based on computer chip technology, diagnostic devices such as nanoarrays are thousands of times more sensitive and accurate than current techniques. Because of their size, multiple lab tests can be so precise, be done more rapidly and at a much lower cost using one nano device instead of many. Nanoshells can be linked to antibodies that recognize tumor cells. Once they are taken up by the cancer cells, near-infrared light is applied, killing only the tumor and leaving neighboring, healthy cells intact. Scientists are engineering nanoparticles, such as dendrimers, to seek out and destroy cancer cells. This amazing technology can be customized for targeted drug delivery, improved imaging, and near real-time confirmation of cancer cell death. Moving research from bench to bedside is an important goal of the National Cancer Institute's Alliance for Nanotechnology in Cancer. A collaborative plan is underway to share research and development information across scientific disciplines and around the world. As biomedical applications of nanotechnology evolve, scientists are ensuring that nano devices are safe for both the body and the environment. The National Cancer Institute is optimistic that through coordinated and responsible development, nanotechnology will dramatically change cancer patient care. The science is at our fingertips.
A virus isn't alive, people. It's non-metabolizing. And look at it. I mean, either it's single-stranded or double-stranded RNA or DNA. And it just happens to have the perfect vector for infection, a protein capsid that just bonds to the cell receptor, and then it penetrates and injects its genetic material. And it's like a program, because a virus can't hurt you by itself. It can't reproduce by itself. It's not alive. Your enzymes have to read it and create what it tells you to create. If they don't do that, it can't hurt you. It's nanotechnology. See, a microbiology student would be like, well, our professor says that viruses come from the rainforest often because it has a similar temperature to a human's body temperature. Yeah, okay. Come on, people, it's technology, all right? There's no reason for a virus to exist in nature. Think about it. What are the odds of that? That you'd have the correct vector, protein capsid around it? Come on. And look at HIV. With AIDS, you get in your immune system, for your white blood cells anyway, you have a system. You have different types of white blood cells. Most of you don't care about this, but in case there's those physiology students out there that need to hear the technical stuff, because I won't be qualified to you unless I know what you know. Yes, I know what those are, the eosinophils, basophils, neutrophils, okay? And then you've got your monomorphs, and those are the T and Bs, and the monocytes, which you call a macrophage when it's in the body because it's mobile. The macrophage is kind of like codons to be a viable fragment of DNA or RNA and deliver the cop. All right, it's always going around your body sampling stuff, looking for anything that it would consider to be an antigen or engulf it. That's why they call it a phagocytical cell, P-H-A-G-O. Phag means to engulf, to eat. Cyte means, well, cell. So it's a phagocyte. So it will engulf it or something that it sees as foreign to the body. So if it finds something like a bacteria that's foreign, that's infective, it will, and then display its material, the contents of the bacteria, on its cell wall. Then it takes a little trip into, say, a lymph node. There you have many white blood cells already there. In fact, you're born with, I guess, up to like 500,000 different types of combinations already there to handle infections. Like, you're already pre-programmed to fight off up to 500,000 different potential infecting agents, right? But it's very generic, so if something new comes into your body, what happens is this macrophage will go in there and say, hey, you know, look what I got. Of course, you know, this is. Anybody, can you handle it? So eventually maybe this macrophage encounters, oh, it's not speaking English, all right, I'm just being metaphorical. It goes in there and says, look, anybody here know what this is? Here, just give me a moment. Let me change a few things. The white blood cell that says, hey, wait, I kind of have something that can deal with that. That's pretty similar to how I'm made. Effectively go after things up. They call this genetic recombination. So it changes its genetic sequencing a little bit so that it can do the infection. Once it's done, and once it's changed itself to be correct and so that it can handle it, it divides and puts clones of itself dormant. They call those memory cells, and that's your immunity, in case that pathogen comes back to the body again, so you don't have to go through this whole process. But when it's identified and says, okay, I'm the one to take care of it, then it will turn on a receptor on its cell wall, and all the other ones will turn their receptors off, and this is a receptor to a substance called interleukin-2. Inter means between, leukin means white blood cell. It's a hormone secreted by your helper cells. And what this hormone does is it causes rapid cell division. They divide fast. I mean, your lymph nodes will literally become packed wall to wall with white blood cells. This is why a doctor will feel your lymph nodes, right? If they're swollen, that means that your immune system is trying to fight something off. HIV goes after the helper cells. The one that secretes interleukin-2. So without that, you don't get the rapid cell division. Yeah, I'm sure that just happened to show up in the rainforest somewhere as a freak of nature. No, man. Viruses are nanotechnology. Viruses add genetic sequences. That's what many of your infections that you pass off as a cold here or the flu there, they're actually changing your DNA. Yes. But how do you resist the virus? What's a carrier? You hear about carriers. Well, this person's a carrier. They're not suffering from the symptoms, but they're a carrier. Well, if you're a carrier, that means that your white blood cells obviously didn't consume the virus. They didn't eradicate the body of the virus. Otherwise, what do you carry? Generally, because the virus is just too small. It's too small or intracellular or something. But why aren't you manifesting symptoms of it? If one person gets the warts virus and expresses warts once and then does not express warts again, and another person gets it and keeps expressing them, what's the difference? Well, the one that doesn't express it figured it out. Hey, this is doing all this stuff. Don't read that, basically. And then transmits that information throughout the entire body. Everybody, listen up. This genetic sequence, don't read it. It does this, 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 and this. Ignore it. And see, the thing about a virus, if you don't read it, if you don't follow its instructions, it can't hurt you. Period.